Hey, everybody, welcome to That Expert Show, where you help run the show. I'm Anna Canzano. Thanks so much for joining us today. We're talking with Jon Gordon, who is absolutely legendary in the field of staying positive. And that's what we need, isn't it? Right now in this bizarre time, it can be difficult to stay positive day to day, especially if you're not naturally inclined to be positive. If you kind of tend toward the negative and maybe are a little more anxious, taking in all the headlines from what's happening around the world right now in the midst of a global pandemic. So I thought it would be a great time to bring him in and get his insight. His best-selling books and talks have been used by Fortune 500 companies all around the world, as well as professional sports teams, college sports teams. They get it. They want to hear what he has to say. He is the author of the book, The Energy Bus, The Carpenter, Training Camp, and a myriad of other bestsellers. He's also a husband and father, so I want to talk to him about those roles as well. Joining us live from Florida right now, Jon Gordon. Jon, thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
Jon, so you just got off the phone, actually probably a Zoom call of some kind, you said, with the UCLA Bruins, with Chip Kelly, who we're very familiar with here in Oregon. What sort of advice were you giving to them?
We talked about grit and what drives grit. So grit drives us. What drives grit? And it's inspired by vision and purpose. It's fueled by optimism and belief. It's powered by faith and hope, driven by love, revived by resilience, kept alive by stubbornness. And if we're honest, includes some fear of failure and desire to improve and to prove oneself. So we talked about that recipe, and then I asked them to come up with their own.
Oh, I like that. Now, I want to give a little bit of your background, because I think a lot of people hear about you and they go, oh, Mr. Positive, you know, Pollyanna, let's look at the world through rose-colored glasses. And they might initially be turned off, but I think what's interesting about you is that you are a self-admitted, not very naturally positive person. And why is that?
I'm a self-admitted pessimistic optimist. And so I am naturally pessimistic. And then I find the eternal hope, eternal optimism that somehow, some way, things are going to get better. I grew up in Long Island, New York, in a Jewish Italian family. A lot of food, a lot of guilt, a lot of wine, a lot of whining. My dad was a New York City police officer, undercover narcotic. So he was shot a few times. He wasn't very positive. And I really struggled with negativity and pessimism and just adversity in my late 20s, early 30s. And my wife had enough of my negativity. She said, I love you, but I'm not going to spend my life with someone who makes me so miserable. Like, you need to change. And it was this huge wake-up call where I looked at myself and realized I needed to change, that this negativity was not being good for my life. It was not helping me become what I wanted to be. And so I started to research ways I could be more positive. And this is not about seeing the world through rose-colored glasses. This is about knowing you have the power to overcome the thorns. This is mindset. This is mental toughness. This is positive leadership. I wrote a book called The Power of Positive Leadership, What Makes Great Leaders Great. And I examined the greatest leaders in history. And guess what? They were positive leaders.
So how do you, you know, how does the average person take that and apply it to their daily life, especially in the midst of crisis right now, where the economy has tanked and there is so much going on in the world that is really beyond our control?
Yeah, we can't control a lot of things right now. And you know what? I'm going through it myself. I'm a speaker. I'm a writer. Well, there's not a lot of events happening right now as a speaker. So I have lost a ton of money. We're talking about $800,000 to $1 million probably in speaking of what I usually do in the course of a year. Usually it's even more than that. And so for me, it's about staying positive through this time, to know that I can't focus on what I've lost. I have to focus on what I will gain. Right now, you can become less or you can become more. You control what you can control and let go of what you can't. And all I can do right now is become better every day. Look for ways to serve and make a difference and focus on staying positive and believing that the best is yet to come. And a lot of us are going through challenging times. And this is knowing that stars shine the brightest through the darkness, but optimistic, positive people shine the most through adversity. And I lost my job during the dot-com crash. So here's the thing. I know what it's like. Like, I had no insurance for my kids, couldn't pay the bills, didn't know what the future held. My wife, you know, we were struggling. And that's when I learned all that I learned. This is I've been there before. So I just want everyone to know this is grounded in reality. This is not something that is very ethereal and something that is very Pollyanna. This is real toughness.
So on your darkest days then, you know, let's go back to the dot-com crash, or maybe you've had some dark days in the midst of this where you realize that speaking engagements that you had booked were dropping off like flies. What did you do? What did you do? Because did you, it's not like being positive is just ignoring the bad feelings and pretending like you're not feeling all of that.
It's confronting the reality. It's about embracing the facts that this isn't good. It's knowing that these facts, this situation is a challenge in times, and you embrace that. And it's okay to not be okay. Let's not hide our feelings. Let's not just ignore them. Let's embrace the fact that we are going to go through stages of grief. There's anger, right? There's denial. There's sadness. There's acceptance. There's meaning. You might go through those in the course of a month. Some of us go through in the course of a day. And when this first started happening, and I was getting all the cancellations of all the events, and our training events were being canceled. I have a team of speakers who work with me, and their events were being canceled. It was tough at first. I'm going to admit that. But then I said, okay, I cannot be negative right now about the situation. I have to lead others. I have to be positive. So here's what you do. You feed yourself so that way we can feed others. You feed yourself with positivity. The best advice I ever heard is from Dr. James Gills, the only person on the planet to complete 6 double Ironman triathlons. That's double Ironman, which means you do an Ironman, and then a day later you do another one. And the last time he did it, 59 years old, asked him how he did it. He said this, I've learned to talk to myself instead of listen to myself. He said, if I listen to myself, I hear all the fear, all the doubt, all the negativity, and all the reasons why I can't finish this race. But if I talk to myself, I can feed myself with the words and the encouragement that I need to keep on moving forward. And I just shared that with the Bruins football players. Like, we got to talk to ourselves right now, not listen. Because if we listen to the negative voices and the fear and the doubt, we will give up. Because we don't give up because it's hard. We give up because we get discouraged. So we need to encourage ourselves with these positive words of encouragement, encourage others on this journey, and allow us to just win today. Like, don't focus too far into the future. We just have to win today, one day at a time. Like, my motto right now is survive and advance from March Madness, survive, advance, but then adapt. We have to adapt and find new ways of doing things, innovate. We're now doing some online training, for example, and then thrive on the other side of this. And knowing that we're going to learn things through this, we're going to grow from this because of this experience, that's going to help us be stronger in the future. And again, that's all we can do. And then also think about all the people that are struggling, all the people that are on the front lines. I got to be honest, I would rather be on the front lines. I'd rather be with those people. Like, I'm trying to get the antibodies test because I believe I have this, because I want to go help those people and serve with those people. And I think about the people that are doing that, and you just have to be thankful for them, thankful for what you have right now, and then optimistic about what we're creating.
Yeah, I mean, when you say that, what comes to mind is, you know, when I was back in the world of reporting, and I went to Walter Reed and interviewed amputee soldiers who had come back from the Iraqi war. It was a whole room full of amputees. And the guy who had lost an arm said, well, at least I'm not as bad as that guy. And I'd look over and that guy had lost 2 arms. I'd interview him and the guy with 2 arms missing would say, well, at least I'm not a triple amputee. And it would go on. And the guy who was now a quadriplegic would say, well, at least I'm still alive. I mean, I'm alive and I'm breathing every day. It was just a matter of incredible perspective to get through each day. Can I ask you a little bit about families? Because and maybe your family is not your, you know, nuclear family that you're living with, but maybe it's your community. Maybe it's your team that you work with in your employment. How can you be a leader? How can you be your best leader in a time like this when you yourself may be full of uncertainty and self-doubt?
Well, one, the research shows we can't be stressed and thankful at the same time. So if you're feeling grateful, you won't be stressed. So the best way to feed yourself each day, talk to yourself, and also practice gratitude. The more you do that, that's going to make you a better leader for others. Being positive doesn't just make you better. It makes everyone around you better. And so just by being positive, you are present. Right now, I have these coaches, various clients, teams, reaching out, John, help us stay positive right now. And that's what I'm doing, just sharing that. And you know what? They get done with the conversation, they get done with the Zoom, and they're like, man, we needed that. I think we just need reminders. So as a leader, you want to make sure you're encouraging yourself, encouraging others. And then three words: love, serve, and care, right? Share your love with others. You're there for them. You're here to be there with them. You're investing in them. You're investing in the relationship. You may reach out via FaceTime. You may reach out via text, or it's a call, or it's a group chat, a group text with your family, with your team, with your colleagues, with your clients. And you're just reaching out and you're encouraging and you're sharing your love for them. You're serving. You're finding some way to serve others. The more you serve others and help others improve, you improve. The more you help others grow, you grow. Woke up in a bad mood this morning, I'm going to be honest. But then I knew I had to speak to UCLA football. I had to encourage them. I had to be there for them. So what did I do? I was now there serving them. And guess what? When I got done, I felt so much better. All that stuff that I was feeling went away because I was pouring into them, right? The best thing you can do to make yourself feel better is to make others feel better. It's ironic that's the way it works, but that's the way it works. It's actually called the Mother Teresa effect. And we have research to show that when we volunteer and help others, our pain and our symptoms of illness and so forth actually go away. You boost your immune system by helping others. And the last word, care. Show that you care. When you show that you care in a world where most don't seem to care anymore, you stand out as a leader. And that caring is what makes people feel that you're there for them. Like, that's really what it comes down to. Do they care about me? And can I trust you? I was watching Mario Cuomo's son, Andrew Cuomo, speak, right? He's the governor of New York, and I was watching him share. And the guy was just very relatable, very, very connecting to the audience of when he was talking about what's going on. And he's showing that he cares, and people feel that connection. That means a lot. Whatever your political affiliation, I was impressed with the way that he showed that he cared. And right now, that's going to go a long way to the people that you lead.
I'm going to press you a little bit about this, because the reality of the situation is that so many people have either lost their jobs, or they've lost 80 to 100% of their income. If they are small business owners, they're in a lot of financial stress and struggle. And someone might be listening to us and say, how is it, I mean, when I feel empty inside, how can I offer anything to anybody else if I am anxiety ridden and I don't know how I'm going to feed my family and whether this business that I have is going to make it, or I don't even know if I get to go back to work? How do you find it in yourself to give to others and pour anything out when you feel empty?
Such a great question. The word anxious literally means divided. And so we're anxious, we feel divided, we feel separate from others. Well, what is the answer to division? It is unity. What unites but love? And so you got to remember that love casts out fear. So the more you love it, the more you won't fear it. So fear dissipates when you're acting in love. So I would say get back to love. And guess what? Again, not just talking about this. I lived through this during the dot-com crash. I had no insurance. I didn't have money in the bank, like literally a month to get us by. I had a restaurant that was opening up. We second mortgaged our home. So I wasn't sure if this restaurant would make money, which it usually takes about 6 months to a year to make money. And I remember feeling that anxiety and that stress and that fear. But that's where I said, you know what? I got to control every day what I can control. I have to stay positive. I have to have faith. I have to continually work to serve my family, serve others. And the crisis reveals what you value, what you believe, and who you are. And you don't want to let your circumstances alter your faith. You want to let your faith alter your circumstances. And so how do you do that when you feel empty? You fill yourself up. You feed yourself. And that's what I'm saying. You have to feed yourself to feed others. Feed yourself each day to feed others. Start reading encouraging words. Start reading. If you're a faithful person, you can read scripture. Start listening to sermons that will encourage you. I've been posting a ton of free stuff on social media right now, more than ever. People are saying I'm helping them through this time. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm doing. I'm here to encourage people. Being positive won't guarantee you'll succeed. I want to be honest. But being negative will guarantee you won't. And I know it's scary. I'm getting the texts and emails too from people that read my newsletter, that have followed me for years, read my books. John, I've lost my job. I'm working on staying positive right now. I'm going to work through this. There is no other way through it. Alan Mulally said, positive leaders find a way forward. He was leading Ford when they were losing $14 billion, became the CEO during that time. I don't know why he took the job, but he took it. Saw it as a great challenge. He had them profitable in a few short years. It was one of the greatest leadership feats in history. How did he do it? He said, everyone had to know the plan, embrace the plan, relentlessly work towards the plan. And he told me, positive leaders find a way. And I think that's the key right now. Find a way. My daughter is literally delivering for Postmates. And so she's supporting herself out in LA. She's an actress and was working as a hostess in a restaurant. Well, guess what? The restaurant is now not in business. So she's now delivering food for Postmates, getting by. Right now, whatever we can do to survive, win today. Don't look too far into the future. Have a vision of the future, optimistically about how you're going to get through it, but win each day, win each moment. A friend of mine's a Navy SEAL, and he said the ones who made it through Hell Week were not the ones who were looking into the future too far. The ones who didn't make it were dreaming about the future and longing for it to end. The ones who made it were the ones who were just saying, let's make it to breakfast. And then let's make it to nighttime. And then let's make it to breakfast again. And so they took this time and they basically focused on small chunks of time, win the moment, win the day. And that's all we can do.
Win the day. I remember that being one of Chip Kelly's sayings as well. Let's talk a little bit about that because I think that part of this whole process, like you hear how people are, you know, gaining the quarantine 15 because we're feeding ourselves. We're just not feeding ourselves necessarily in a healthy way. We're eating like Doritos and all kinds of other things. Or you're seeing that, you know, alcohol sales are through the roof. People are doing, they're kind of leaning back on behaviors that may be exacerbated in this process of trying to get by. But let's talk about another type of intake, which is the intake of news. Like we all need to consume news right now to stay up to date with what is happening. But is there a way to consume news in a way that doesn't consume us?
Yeah, great question. Use it for information and then shut it off. Get your information that you need and then shut it off. I think we're watching too much news. I know, for instance, I am as well. When I watch it too much, I start to get down. I start to buy in to the doom and the gloom. And I decided I'm not doing that anymore. I'm investing in hope, optimism, and belief. So get our news, social media, newspapers, TV for a little bit, and then turn it off, because the rest of it is just going to make you more fearful and cause you to panic more. And really is ultimately fear that we're experiencing. And that fear is driving us to do crazy things. People are buying all that toilet paper. Why? Because of fear. People are going out and thinking that when they walk outside, for some reason, they're going to catch the virus just by walking outside. No, the research shows that actually sunlight kills the virus. So you want to get some sunlight. So when they say stay at home, they should stay at home and get outside and get some sunlight because it's healthy. So I'm walking in the morning. I walk in the evening. I'm working towards during the middle of the day. And I'm also being active and I'm working on creating things. I find if I watch the news too much, it really does bring me down. The news is all about the negative. If it bleeds, it leads. We know that. And so they're going to lead with the most negative story because that's what gets your attention. So the news media right now is having high ratings and they are thrilled. But look at all the advertisements on these shows. All these advertisements are things that try to make you feel better in a certain way. They're drugs and so forth to make you feel better because you're now depressed watching the news. Isn't that a little crazy? So we have to find other ways to feel better. When you get up in the morning, you can rise and shine or rise and whine. And I don't mean W-I-N-E. You don't want to rise and W-I-N-E. But the fact that you said liquor sales is going up is a great example that we're looking to fill ourselves up with things that make us feel better. But that doesn't make us feel better in the long run. It may in the moment. But we have to fill ourselves up with the natural positive things that help us create what we want to create. Right now, you can become more or you can become less. And becoming more, you don't want to gain that 15 more, right? I mean more of who you want to be. And whatever you're doing right now, work on adapting, developing, and understanding that this discomfort you're feeling now, on the other side of this, will be growth. On the other side of it. Hard to see now, but it will on the other side of it. And unless you've been through it, you may not think it, but I've been through it. And I think that's why I'm so confident, because I know what it's like to be this close to losing it all. And I know that some people might lose something financially, but you're not going to lose. You're not going to lose in the long run if you stay positive and find a way forward. You will get through this. We got another month probably at most of quarantine in most places. After that, things are going to open up. Things are going to come around back around in the summer, giving way to a great fall. And I truly believe there are things to look forward to. People are going to be hired back. And that's the optimism you have to have. Expect the best, prepare for the worst, right? Or prepare for the worst, expect the best. I think that's a great mindset to have right now.
It's interesting because I was just asking people over the weekend, you know, what are you most looking forward to when this is over, I guess, when things open up again? And the number one thing people said was seeing their loved ones, getting and giving hugs. I mean, it was very simple across the board. People crave that interaction. You've had so many interactions with people of all different deeply.
I sort of lost that last part.
Oh, I was just wondering, do you find that people are like inherently hopeful or inherently pessimistic?
I think most people are inherently hopeful. We all need something to long for and something to hope for. It's human nature to long for something and hope for something. So I think we are hopeful. I think, again, we have to accept the facts of where we are today, confront the brutal facts. It's the Stockdale paradox, but be positive and optimistic about the future. Telescope, microscope, telescope, big picture vision, zoom focus on what you need to do today to get better. But I think people are hopeful. I'm looking forward to connecting with people again. I miss the human interaction of speaking, not just on Zoom, which I've been doing a ton of. I'm almost zoomed out, but then so much of this, but I miss the human interaction, and that's what I miss most. And people are saying, like, you're going to really miss the amount of time you're spending with your family, because so many families are spending a lot of time right now. And I'm like, I'm looking forward to missing my family again.
To have that option.
Yes, so exactly.
As we talk about family, are there best practices that you would recommend that families do on a regular basis outside of this whole pandemic situation that we're facing right now? Are there rituals that you implement as the husband and father in your home that you would suggest for others?
Best thing we ever did as a family was a family meeting, where once a week we would get together around the table and we would talk. We would talk about our mission statement. We would talk about our one words for the year. Each family member would pick a word for the year that would drive them to be their best. Like, my word this year is heart. I want to live with more heart. And so each year we would pick our words and we'd talk about them. And then we'd talk about our challenges that we were going through, and we would give each other solutions on how to overcome the challenges we were facing. We found out a lot of things that our kids were going through during those table meetings. And some people call that dinner, but this was different. We were really intentional about sitting down and talking about these things. Then I would read something inspirational from a book that I was reading or a video that I had watched, and I would share that with the family. They didn't want to read my stuff or hear my stuff. So I would bring outside voices in and share that with the family. And we grew a lot during that time. It was the best thing we've ever done. This is a great time right now to talk about what you're going through as a family. What does each person think? How do they view this crisis? What are some solutions that they have? What do they think is going to happen in the future? How can we get better right now as a family because of it? What are we learning as we go through this? Really great things we can talk about as a family in order to get better.
And you were saying that you were having that family meeting. What is the timeline for that? Is that weekly? Is that monthly?
For us, it was a weekly meeting, and we would meet every Sunday. My kids both played sports, and I was on the road a lot. So this was the time that we could all get together once a week and bond. When I work with sports teams or corporate teams, I have them bond, and we do these team building exercises where I get them sharing and talking with each other. The vulnerability that they have and the authenticity paves the way for meaningful relationships and strong connections. So one of my expertise is in developing connected and committed teams that perform at a higher level. Well, the best thing you can do as a team at home is to connect, so that way you're more committed to each other. And even right now, we're on a group text. So our daughter's still out in LA. My son is back home from college. He's 19, actually just turned 20 yesterday. My daughter is 21, going to be 22 in July. So, you know, we're still bonded by doing a group text as a family. And we do Snapchat together where we all have a separate Snapchat story and we share things via Snapchat with each other.
That's great. How hard is it to change the dynamic of either a family, a team, a business team, a community, if they're already trending toward negative? How easy or difficult is it to shift that energy?
It's harder, but it always depends on the leader, right? Working with Oregon football and Mario Cristobal, how he came in and built a great culture and great leadership. So the leader always drives the culture. And if you have great leadership that practices love tough, they love their team, but they hold them accountable to the standards and the culture and the values and the principles, well, then that leader is going to really create a great culture. And then you have to get people to buy into that culture. So the more you can get people to buy in, the faster it turns around. And so getting that buying is key. But through relationships is how you do that. And great leaders create great relationships. And so I could see it over and over again. That's what happens. I work with Clemson football the last 8 years, and I've seen how Dabo Sweeney has built an amazing program. I work with the Dodgers and the Rams, and Dave Roberts came in and made the Dodgers a winner, and the Rams, Sean McVay, did an incredible job, especially his first season. So you just see how great leaders build great cultures, and you need people who are willing to get on the bus and get moving in the right direction with a shared vision, focus, and purpose.
Jon Gordon, thank you so much for your insight today.
Hey, thanks for having me.
And thank you for joining me for this episode of That Expert Show. I hope you found it helpful. We will be creating a tip sheet based on everything Jon talked about. As we do with every episode, we'll be posting that at thatexpertshow.com. You can check us out as a YouTube, and if it's easier, you can check us out as a podcast. We're on Apple iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Spotify, TuneIn, all those good places. You can listen to our show. Hey, connect with me on social media. I would love to hear from you. What did you think of this show? What other shows would you like us to do? I'm on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Just look for Anna Canzano. Thanks so much for being part of the conversation. Your input is really what helps drive this show. So subscribe if you can. Share this show with others, particularly this episode. It can help so many. And leave us a review. I would really appreciate that because that helps others find us. It is called That Expert Show, and it's where you help run the show.